Welcome to the Seven Figure Fundraising Podcast, the podcast where we discuss specific tactics and strategies to grow your nonprofit. I'm your host, Trevor Bragdon. We're excited to be kicking off the second season of the Seven Figure Fundraising Podcast, and our first guest is Horst Schulze. Horst is a co-founder and chairman of the Capella Hotel Group and co-founder and former president of the Ritz-Carlton Hotel Company. Horst is a legendary leader and titan of international business. Under his leadership, the Ritz-Carlton was voted the best hotel company in the world by numerous convention and trade publications. His innovative principles have reshaped the concept of excellence, service, and competitive advantage. Last year, Horst released the book Excellence Wins, which describes his leadership and approach to customer service. Thanks for being on, and we're really excited to have you on the Seven Figure Fundraising Podcast. You've had such a great career, both running and co-founding the Ritz-Carlton Hotels, and then also being the founder and CEO of the Capella Hotel Group. Do you want to tell us about how you got started in the hotel industry, and then what made you decide to write your book that just came out last year, Excellence Wins?
I started in the hotel industry about in a little bit of a strange way. I kind of explained in the book, I for some reason, I must have read something about the hotel business. When I was 11 years old, I went to my parents, told them I want to work in the hotel business, which was unthinkable in a small village where there was no hotel. I don't know how I ever got the idea. But eventually, my parents found a busboy job in a hotel 100 kilometers away from home, where they eventually took me. I lived there in a dorm room. I was lucky. It changed my life in many ways, of course, being away from home at 14 and so on. But the maitre d' of the hotel, the manager of restaurants, if you will, was an unusual person. He welcomed me in the first day. He said, "Now that you're here, do not come to work for work itself. Come here every morning to be excellent in what you're doing, to create excellence." Now, that went over my head at the time with 14. What's excellence about cleaning ashtrays and washing dishes? Because that's what I did. But it took a while, and he didn't give up on us young people. I wasn't the only one there, obviously. He kept on telling us, every day you define yourself, etc. And it impacted my life dramatically. In fact, if I can continue that for a moment, number of years later, he had passed away in the meantime. I worked in San Francisco in the Hilton as a room service waiter. And it was my dream to be promoted to room service supervisor. If I could accomplish that, I would go back to Europe, continue my career, etc. I knew I was a great waiter. I had worked in the best places in Europe in the meantime. But another guy got promoted. And once I overcame my ego pain for the first few months, I admitted that he deserved it more than I did, that I came to work sometimes in the morning a few minutes late. I wasn't only tired. You could see that I was tired. And when the manager said something to me, do this or do that, a little bit unusual, I said, why me? Why not somebody else? The guy that got promoted never said that. He never was late. And I went back to my little room in my little furnished room at the time in San Francisco, and I talked to my maitre d', that old manager who had passed away, as I said. But I talked to him and I said, I'm sorry. I went to work and not to create excellence. And I promised him it would never, ever happen again. I'm going to work every day just like you taught me, to be excellent and not just to work, which I did. And that's why. And eventually I got my promotion and my career took off dramatically from there on.
And what made you have that insight to, you know, have that conversation that with that mentor, even though he had passed away, you know, kind of imagine what he would say to you? What made you think about that?
Interesting enough, I'm a typical German upbringing. When I worked in that hotel, once a week we went to hotel school. And he kept on, that melody kept on telling us, don't just work, be excellent at what you're doing. And he was an example of excellence. Now, when I went after 2 years, in the meantime, I started to understand what he meant, because I could see that everybody in the restaurant respected him. Every guest, very famous people in the restaurant, respected him because of the excellence that he created. So I wrote an essay in that school, and I named that essay, "We Are Ladies and Gentlemen, Serving Ladies and Gentlemen." We define ourselves, no matter what we do in life, by the excellence that we create at work or that we create in our life as a whole. And of course, much of our life is work. And that is where we define ourselves. And we either define ourselves as mediocrity or as people of excellence. It's up to us. And that's the essay that I wrote. So he impacted me greatly. But as I said, going on from there, working in many places in Europe, in the finest places, I had kind of dismissed it. But that day, I knew I didn't create excellence. I didn't define myself as the best. I didn't define myself as excellent. And that's why I didn't get my promotion. And I was reminded, it's up to me, just as I wrote in that essay many years before.
Right. And it's such great framing, the whole ladies and gentlemen, serving ladies and gentlemen, because people could think of it as like you're subservient to your guest or something like that. But you're...
No, we're not. We're not. We are equal to them. If we create excellence in what we're doing, if we're not equal anymore. We define ourselves as something low.
Right. That's such a great point. Well, one of the things I wanted to ask you about with, you've had the book out for over a year. Is there anything you wish you had added that like was left at the cutting room floor, or things you wish you'd expanded on now that you've been talking about it and having feedback?
It will be out a year in March, coming March. No, I don't know. I'm pretty satisfied with what happened. I tried to tell a story. I didn't try to write the typical business book. I tried to write a book that young people wouldn't put away after a few pages. And frankly, I was hoping that CEOs who read it have a little bit of a bad conscience, meaning they're reminded that excellence creates successes, and excellence is created through excellent leadership of people. That's the message I try to give to CEOs, and the message to young people, I try to say, you can make it. Just make a decision for excellence. And you can have a great career and be fulfilled in life.
Right. Well, and one of the things that's interesting about the themes through the book and through your leadership is how much you have just very clear principles of excellence that you instill with your employees. And then you repeat them in a fashion like monthly or weekly, but you create this cadence where they're reminded of the standard of excellence. Can you talk about that and where you came up with those ideas and how you implemented them?
Yeah. Well, what I clearly have to do is create a vision of what I want to be as an individual or as an organization. When I started Ritz-Carlton, I joined this company that had no hotels, mind you. When I joined, they decided to create a new hotel company. They were developers and financial people. And I joined this group only because they basically told me that I could do what I want with this new company that they were forming and operationally in the hotel business. And I went for a dream. And my decision was I will create the finest hotel company in the world. That was the dream. That was the vision. And of course, so I have to hire people that joined me. And in that discussion, it's very clear leadership has a vision. That is clear. But as long as the vision, and it's excellent leadership, if the vision is good for all concerned. In my case, I had to question myself, not just a simple question, but actually agonize, say, is my vision good for the investors? Is it good for the customer? Is it good for every employee? Is it good for society as a whole? Once I can clearly establish, yes, this vision, the closer I come to that vision, the more I serve those four, investor, employee, customer, and society. And then, of course, I have to decide, how am I going to get to that vision? And the vision was to be superior to the competition. And so I had to study what does the customer want. And it's not better for me, better for the customer. If my product is better for the customer than the competition creates, in that moment, I will sooner or later have a successful business. So we studied, what does the customer want? What is it what makes a great company superior to the competition? And we came up with 20 points. And those 20 points, we teach immediately when an employee starts working. After we selected an employee, basically the first day of work or the second day of work, they learn those 20 principles which are non-negotiable. This we have to do. In these 20 principles, we have to be superior to the competition. And then we repeated those 20 principles one at a time, every day. Today, it may be point 11. If you get a complaint, you own it. If you're the waiter and the guest complains about the toilet, you own the toilet. It's not they. No, please forgive me. So that's today. Point 11. In 20 days, 20.11 will be repeated again. Tomorrow is point 12. If a guest asks for direction, don't point. Take them where they want to go, where they want to. So be sure to find it. And that will be repeated again 20 days later and so on. So we do not the 20 pieces that we know will make us superior. We don't let them just go and teach them once and hope for the best. We create a process to be sure it stays front of mind for every employee.
And how do you keep it from getting stale? Like you've been there 5 years and you've heard, you know, you can list off, I need to own the complaint. You know, the complaint comes to me and I need to own it. You know, how do you prevent that from being stale?
Of course, many managers didn't do it. I found out after a while many managers didn't do it because they were embarrassed to repeat the same story, which I had repeated so many times now. And finally, I had a discussion with our general manager in every hotel. We got them all together and said, okay, is anyone in the room? That was my question. Who doesn't know Coca-Cola? Raise your hand. I said, none of you raise your hand. So you all know Coca-Cola. Then, by the way, Coca-Cola knows that you know what Coca-Cola is. Yet they spend billions to advertise. Why do they do that? To keep it front of mind. So let's agree that we will do this from now on. And since it is so important for all concerned, because this is non-negotiable, this will make us the best in the world for the benefit of all concerned. Again, investor, employee, customer, and society. We have no moral right to compromise it. So I have, as a leader, have to say, if you compromise and not do it, then I will fire you. This had to be a rule. And mm-hmm. So everybody understood and it wasn't missed anymore. But of course, we made it interesting. We gave them guides of what to discuss this time. We responded to guest comments relative to the base of the day. We told stories around and so on to keep it interesting.
Yeah, that's great. Well, and nothing like knowing that you could be fired to help you make sure you implement it.
Yeah, well, you know, I, as a leader, since it was absolutely unequivocally clear, the four constituents that I serve, again, you know who they are, I had no moral right to compromise. I had no moral right. How can, if I compromise it, I'm going against every employee, against every investor. I had no right. So I had to draw a line and made it very clear, those points are non-negotiable.
Right. Well, and you took that ownership right from the top. It's not like you were doing something different and then expecting them to do it. One thing you talk about in the book is the importance of listening to your customers through surveys, through, you know, various focus groups and those sort of things. But, you know, Henry Ford said that if he had listened to customers, he would have just built a faster horse. So can you talk to us about the difference between listening to the customers, what they say versus what they actually mean, and what your experience has been?
We were very conscious of understanding the customer expectation and living up to it. And not only did we ask the customers, we really listened to every trend. And we were very scientific about it. In fact, in some cases, we had word analysts sitting into focus group to understand not what they said, what they really meant, so that we could really adjust to the customer's expectation and create processes around what the customer wanted. You see, that's concentrating on the product. If I can make my product better than the competition, and my product is in the eyes of the customer, then I'm going to sooner or later make money. The problem with most organizations, they concentrate on the money. I said, we concentrate on the stuff that makes money. And that is customer satisfaction. If I can convince a customer to want to come back, I win. And I can convince the customer to come back. And we measure that every month, by the way. We measured it every day. But I looked at every month, once a month, in every hotel, how many percent of the customers want to come back and want to recommend us top box. And if it dropped under 92%, I expected that 92% of our guests say, top box, I want to come back here and I want to recommend you. If it dropped under 92%, I interceded. I talked to the general managers. I offered help, etc. And of course, you can only accomplish that if you do what the customer wants and not what you want. It's not about me. It's about the customer.
Right. Well, and a couple of things I just want to unpack there, which I think are great, is that whole focus on what makes you money, not what costs you money. You have this line in the book that just I've thought about since I read it back in May and then reread it for this interview, but about how any manager can go cut the fresh flowers from a Ritz-Carlton lobby. But what does that do for your customer? It lowers their experience of excellence and doesn't create that, you know, creates a short-term gain, but not a long-term benefit.
Yeah. And here's a major problem in American business and in Western businesses, nothing to do with America, but it is the manager that cut costs gets applauded. You see, if the corporate office is somewhere in New York and the hotel, that goes in any business. It could be a shoe store, a chain of shoe stores. It doesn't matter. I'm talking about hotels. But the corporate office in New York and the general manager in California or in Dubai takes the flowers away, buys cheaper soap. The analyst in New York said, look what a great manager. He just lowered cost.
Right.
And that manager gets applauded while he is destroying the brand.
Right. It's the first order effects versus the second, first order, third.
That's what happens. That's what happens. Oh, what a wonderful general manager. Look, he's cutting costs. He spends less money for amenities like flowers than anybody else, but he has a bad-looking lobby.
Right. Well, and how do you protect, as a leader, like when you oversee managers, how do you watch for something like that, where they're getting results from thinking short-term versus longer-term thinking?
By careful measurements. Everything what's important has to be measured. And the key measurement, of course, is customer satisfaction. What is the feedback customers give you? That's the key measurement. The next key measurement is employee satisfaction, etc. So you measure all kinds of things. And that's why we have an ongoing analysis of customer satisfaction, customer feedback. And when their trends go negative, then you intercede. Everybody has to understand in the organization, we do not accept compromises on service that have been established. Everybody has to understand that. Everybody has to understand that they're responsible to do that. And they have to understand it's being measured.
Right.
And that they get applauded for excellence and not for negative things that they're doing.
Right. So when you look at nonprofits and they have this 70% retention rate, and that's really high for their industry, you know, where it's, I think the average is about 51%. What do you think they're doing wrong with donors that's not getting them to renew, for the donors to renew?
What we look for in the customer retention for us, donor retention, customer retention, is to understand that every interaction that we have is a moment where we have to convince the guest to be loyal to us. It doesn't matter who has a connection. That's the moment, not to raise money. That's the moment. The moment when you have a contact is the moment to convince the guest to want to come back, to convince the owner, the donor, to keep on working with you. If you would walk into Capella Hotel today, now I'm not connected anymore. I sold the company, to be clear. But if you would walk into Capella Hotel, you walked into the kitchen in the far back corner where there's a guy washing dishes or pots, and ask this pot washer, what is your objective here? He won't answer washing pots. He will say, I am here to convince the guests to want to come back because of what I'm doing. And that's really what it is. The front desk is not there to check them in. The front desk is there to convince them to want to come back. And that has to be the mental attitude with every interaction that you have with a donor or with a customer or with a patient or whatever you call them. That has to be, I have to convince you now that you want to deal with me, you, that it is worthwhile dealing with you, that we appreciate that you deal with me, that we applaud you, that we honor you, that we think you're important to us. You have to give them that. We teach the moment when the customer walks in, within 10 feet, you look them in the eye and make them feel with your eyes that we're glad that they're there. Convince them to want to come back. Welcome. I'm here, you're here. And teach yourself, after every transaction, how could I have done this better? If you start teaching yourself, after every single customer contact, donor contact, and question yourself, how could I have met this better? So that's what it is. We have to convince them. The human being, on the other hand, wants to know that they're appreciated, that they're respected, that they're donating. And of course, donating is something that is serving. Mm-hmm. And it's worthwhile for worlds and you for humanity or whatever it is. I have to convince the guests too that it's worthwhile to stay with me rather than next door where they pay $50 less.
Right.
But they have to show them that I'm going to give them value, that there is value in speed dealing with me. And at the same time, that I respect them and honor them.
Right.
They're human beings. They want to feel good. They want to be respected.
Right. Well, and I think it's so easy as fundraisers to think that once you get the yes, that they're going to send in the check, like your job's done. But like from the perspective of the donor, it's like that's when the relationship's just beginning. It's like the customer coming to the hotel. It doesn't do them any good unless they're treated like a way that they want to make them come back. And the same with our donors.
That's your chance starts. It's selling, advertising, promoting, everything, all the thing, word of mouth, everything. But your real chance is when you make that one contact, when they walk into the hotel, when they actually deal with you, that gives you a chance to say thank you. That gives you a chance to convince them to donate again. But donating and then being ignored, look here, I have experienced that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've experienced that or getting a very cold communication. It's time to donate again. Wait a minute. It's time to send me money. No. But in fact, I made a call yesterday and told somebody, look here, take me off the list because the way you wrote me a letter here, you want to make me feel bad because I haven't sent you any money. You must be kidding me.
Right.
No. But if you would have said, I still appreciate you, but I still need help. And here's why we still need help. Then I would have not responded like that. Literally, I'm not exaggerating. Mm-hmm. Yesterday morning, I made that call.
Wow.
Now they contacted me. Now they became nice. Why not before?
Right. Well, and I think sometimes nonprofits, they think, well, we sent out the thank you letter, we sent out the acknowledgement, but they don't actually think about what it means. And if you're giving a significant amount of money, does that reflect the language in the letter? What you talked about with cold, you know, it's no emotion, not talking about what they've done.
My gosh, spill out your heart. Don't be practical and wise. You come from a wonderful college and you learn some good words. No, speak from your heart. We love you and we thank you and we need you, don't you?
Right. No, that's exactly right. So what advice would you give to nonprofit leaders, specifically on that donor communication, like how they could improve it? What are some systems that they could put in place to make sure they don't have that experience that nonprofit just did with you yesterday?
In that hotel, in that relationship, it deals with human beings. And that's what I'm really referring to. I'm not pretending to be an expert whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Yes, you raise the money, you get a donation, you send a good letter back. It cannot be ending there. I would send a second and third note back within the year and say again, here's what we have done in the meantime. I just want to say, if it wasn't for you, it wouldn't have been possible. And you are doing something for the world. You have done something. why not a second son? Not asking for money. Make it very clear, we're not asking for money here. We just feel like thanking you. When I called them, said, we just felt to talk to you personally, say to you, thank you. You're important to us. And you have done something important in the world.
Right. Well, in all of those strategies, sending a couple extra letters, doing a phone call, they don't have to cost a nonprofit a lot of money. And most of the things you talk about, you did at the Capella and at the Ritz-Carlton, didn't cost a lot of money. It was just people responding in a certain way and making the customer feel valued.
Yeah, it's so interesting. In the beginning years when we had Ritz-Carlton, the whole industry was talking about, mind you, we were a private company. Nobody knew our numbers and so on. We were privately owned. The whole industry was talking about that we are nothing but losing money, that we made more money than they ever did. What costs so much money by looking somebody in the eye and saying, welcome? Of course, our towels were a little bit more expensive, but we charged more. In fact, Good Housekeeping had us as best hotel value, even though everywhere we were the most expensive. But we gave value. And at the same time, we made the profits necessary to continue growing. Exceptional. Thus, most of the stuff that we did better. And if you would read it, 20 things, not one of them costs money. Looking people in the eyes within 10 feet and say welcome and mean it, using the right words and mean it, doesn't cost money.
So if a leader's listening to this and they're wanting to implement, you know, come up with their own either list of values with their organization that their employees can remember, these, you know, making sure, convincing them to return again, where have you seen leaders kind of fall down trying to implement this in their own organizations?
Most of the time, they feel kind of silly to, it's an ego thing, it seems, so an insecurity thing. I'm amazed about it, that repeating every day. I mean, and I, in the very beginning, I was ridiculed with my car that everybody had. I was just so ridiculed, and now most people have it, but you have to force yourself. It's an ego thing. For example, I worked with a major law firm. They were exuberant to do this, to create their value statements and study it and say, here are the 20 things, and now let's repeat it every day. Absolutely, but not the lawyers. Just the rest of the people. And the breakdowns that is mind-boggling, frankly, to me. I'm working with a wonderful little bank in Texas. And when I started working with them consulting, as I do with several other companies, I don't take hotel consulting, just other companies.
Right.
But with this bank, I asked in the beginning the CEO, please assign somebody to me that can follow up in this consulting. Oh, sure. So they assigned two regional presidents. It worked perfectly. The bank is flourishing. It is exciting to work with them. It is unbelievable. I worked with another group in Texas, and I don't want to name it, not a bank, another company. And I said, please assign somebody. And when I came there, they assigned an intern to me. Like, come on. That's what I mean. The CEOs don't take it serious. They just look again, wait a minute, how many dollars, how many that, how many transactions, instead of being willing to concentrate on the customer and create a product superior to the competition where the world knows they are the best in doing X. That's what it's all about. And then you get customers, and then you keep the customers, and then, by the way, you make money.
Right. Well, and that whole focus on the things that generate money, not the things that cost, like
that's
incorporating
it.
That.
Exactly.
Right. And how long do you find it takes to implement? Like, if you're bought in, your leadership is bought in, not, you know, your intern that you're assigned, which is crazy, but like your leadership's bought in and you're repeating these mantras or these principles in your office. Like, how long do you see before employees start to change?
Very fast. Let me stay with this little bank in Texas, which is growing rapidly. It's a major success. We started, for instance, this daily huddle, this daily get-together. They were so exuberant that suddenly they were informed every day for a few minutes. Not only did we teach at one point, we always give information about the company as a whole. Suddenly they were respected. The employees bought, we have crazy success crazy success there. Even though there were existing employees and became new with that. Now, in my case, in Ritz-Carlton, was much easier because every location was new. We hired new employees. We took over some hotels and worked there too. There it took a little longer. A new hotel, where this was the very essence of hiring and selecting, and the first day of work orientation, which is very important. We gave them all those details. In a takeover hotel, where there was a hotel that was running for many years, suddenly we took it over and we come with those new thoughts. It worked just as well, but it took longer. It took 6 months before you buy. And there was a suspicion in the beginning, that is just talk. Mm-hmm. They don't really mean it. But once they saw we meant it, this is who we are. This is our heart and soul of working. We believe in the employee. We believe in the customer. We believe in the community where we do business. That sounds in the beginning, it's a corporate speech. But we live by it, and then you get buy-in. And that usually was after 6 months, they were fully integrated into the thinking of the organization.
Right. So for smaller teams, it might be 90 days to 6 months is what you should commit to minimally to get this done.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So one of the interesting things I think about utilizing your rules of customer service and treating everyone with such a level of respect is how it's been spread throughout all these different businesses and not just hotels. And can you talk to us a little bit about how you incorporated some of these Ritz-Carlton level principles at fast food companies like Chick-fil-A?
Yeah, it all is the same. It doesn't matter if it is a hardware store or a Chick-fil-A or a Ritz-Carlton. The customer wants to be respected and feel good. And let's talk about that for a moment. I don't want customer satisfaction. I want customer loyalty, as I touched on. What is customer loyalty? If that is in your business or any business, as soon as you deal with people, customer loyalty is nothing more, but they trust you. They trust what you do. They trust that you care. They trust your product. They trust your efforts. And that's a trust I have to develop. If that is Chick-fil-A or in a fundraising organization, they have to trust you. They have to trust that your effort has value, is worthwhile, that what you're doing is worthwhile. They have to trust you as an individual, like it or not. Human beings base their opinion about a company or about an organization is developed by the contact they have with the human being in that organization. And that's why when I have B2B and so on, then forget it. The opinion is created by human beings through the other human being somehow. Even if it's on the telephone, doesn't matter. It still was done by human beings. That's what I have to accomplish. And Chick-fil-A, for example, the same way. I mean, I work with Chick-fil-A. I work with other organizations. I work with a bank. What do? You convince everybody who walks in that you care for them. How do you do that? By looking them out and welcoming them. If, for example, in Ritz-Carlton, we said in the first step of service is welcome. And how do you make that a good welcome in Ritz-Carlton? By saying hi? No. If I say hi, I'm saying to you, I'm equal with you. You're not more important than I am. If I say, welcome, sir, good morning, or good morning, ma'am, how are you today? I'm saying, I respect you. But at the same time, I'm saying, I'm professional. It's every contact. We have to understand everything communicate. My letter, that's why I talked about the letter before. Mm-hmm. It communicates. You have to say, am I communicating the right thing here? Am I saying that I respect you? Am I saying that I'm professional? Am I saying that you can trust me? That's what I have to question myself in every contact. And it doesn't matter if it's Chick-fil-A or where. Like in Chick-fil-A, for instance, I said, don't say okay. Like in Ritz-Carlton, and I told them at the time, don't say okay when somebody gives the order. Say I'm happy to. And I said, in Ritz-Carlton, we say my pleasure. Here's what I told them. I don't think you should say my pleasure. It doesn't quite fit your market segment. But in the back was Stuart Cathy, the founder of Chick-fil-A. And he said, I like my pleasure. And so they use my pleasure. And you see, it says, when you go to Chick-fil-A, come on, let's be honest. Forgive me, Chick-fil-A. anybody can cook a chicken breast, but you feel better in Chick-fil-A because they respect you. The surrounding is clean. It's fast. The food is good. Mm-hmm. No argument. And you're being respected as a human being when you're there. That makes a difference. Why they're the better fast food company of all the companies, fast food companies.
Right. Well, and what's interesting here in my town, we have a Chick-fil-A down the street, and they say my pleasure, and there's a Dunkin' Donuts right across the street from it. And they say it too, but they don't look. But what's funny is they don't look you in the eye, and they just kind of say it like they're like, say it as like just a thing to check off the list. So it's just funny. You see the contrast, you know, between, you know, that
sure,
acknowledgement.
You have to mean it.
Right. Versus you can do all the right things, but if you don't mean it, it doesn't matter.
And that comes from leadership.
Right. Yeah. They're saying this is a good idea. We should copy that versus we actually mean it. So to wrap up, and I appreciate you taking so much time with us, we like to challenge nonprofit leaders on this podcast to take action with what they've heard today. What would you recommend that they do, like one thing they could do in their organizations based on your book, you know, besides go buy your book, Excellence Wins?
That, I would have said that.
Right. But besides that, what would you recommend they do to implement this in their own nonprofits?
Look at the whole thing as a process. Don't hire people anymore. Select people. Be very careful who you hire. Select them. And one step, Sean, you make sure that they're part of your organization. That means establish a common vision. Establish a purpose for all concerned. Adam Smith said so 300 years ago. Aristotle said so 3,000 years ago. People need to be part of, have to have purpose, be part of a purpose and belong. Make sure they belong. They're part of you. And the part of you starts with having a common purpose. Now you're aligned. Don't talk about alignment. Every company has this buzzword of alignment. And then when you ask, what is the company standing for? What's the objective of the company? The employee doesn't know. So how are you aligned? Alignment means, and that's what is key here, that every employee understands where the organization wants to accomplish and why, what the organization is, feels. Every employee said, and every employee understands what the customer expects from you. If those two are clear to every single employee and every single employee is aligned, then you have an organization that is aligned. And that's the key element. Create a common purpose for your organization.
Great. And that's such great advice because we all have mission statements, but the purpose is something simpler, shorter, that's really clear for them to repeat and implement.
And I have to add to it. I deal with companies, they have a mission statement, a vision statement, but the employees don't know it.
Right.
It's written in an annual report. That's all.
Yeah. And what good does it do? Right. Yeah. Just being up on the wall or in an annual report.
And when you hire people to join your dream, your mission, your purpose. Don't hire them for a function. The chair in which you're sitting is fulfilling a function. You're dealing with human beings. Hire them to join your purpose and then teach the function, of course.
Right. That's such great advice. Well, where can people find out more about Excellence Wins and about you, Horst?
In fact, you could text Horst, H-O-R-S-T, 7979. You can get more information out of there, as far as I know. Or look at the book. It has details of contact, too. So by all means, and of course, the internet.
Right. So they can text Horst, H-O-R-S-T, to 7979. Go and visit horstschultz.com or look for Excellence Wins on Amazon and wherever books are sold.
That's right.
It really is a great book. So much practical advice in it. And it's written by someone who's actually done it, not somebody who's just analyzing the Ritz-Carlton from afar. It's really what works today. So thanks so much for being on the show, Horst. It's been a pleasure talking with you.
Honored to be with you.
Thank you. Thanks for listening. To learn more about Seven Figure Fundraising and our training, visit sevenfigurefundraising.com. Finally, if there's one person you know would benefit from hearing this episode, please take a minute and share it with them. Thanks.